with a French accent. I hope you don't mind. I hope you're going to understand. So today is going to be about the business model canvas. Before we dive in into the topic, I'm just going to introduce myself very quickly. I got 5 years experience in financial services. I'm taking care of the investment arm of Incube, basically looking for startups that will benefit the whole group, that will be able to build synergies with. That's really the mandate here. So just to give you an overview of what Incube does, we are aiming at becoming an end-to-end service provider to startups. So what does it mean? It means that first, we want to inspire entrepreneurs. That might be entrepreneurs that have an idea, but that don't have, you know, business model yet. They don't have a prototype yet. So we are trying to ignite the sense of entrepreneurship into them and push them into becoming someone that can access to an incubation or innovation program, as we call it here. So the innovation program, we run it. That's 5 days of intense mentoring that we provide over 2 weeks. And at the end of the last day, we ask all the startups to pitch. We select 20 companies per batch for this case. And the winners of the innovation program will be able to pass on to the next stage of the incubation and acceleration program. Incubation and scale-up program, as we call it, is something that we organize twice a year. That's for more mature companies, for companies that already have a prototype. And from this stage on, we provide funding. So in this case, we provide 700,000 bahts of cash, as well as 1 baht of in-kind media value. We combine all of this, and we ask between 5 and 9% of ownership stake in the startup. So this year, you still have 1 month if you want to apply for this incubation and scale-up program. The applications close on the 30th of April this year. So if you have a startup, if you have a prototype, you please apply for it. And this year, we're going to innovate by actually bringing our TV crew, and we will shoot the mentoring sessions, and we will follow all the startups during the 3 months of the bootcamp. And that will be broadcasted on Truth Vision. So it's going to be a great way to advertise your startup. So far, I've described our incubation and acceleration programs, which are Inspire, Innovate, Incubate. And I haven't talked about Invest. Invest is the investment arm of Incube. And our first initiative, because we've launched it very recently, is something that we're going to call the Ecosystem Fund. We aim at investing 200,000 bahts into 100 startups by the end of the year. This is grant money. We won't get any equity in any startup that we're going to provide the 200,000 baht in. So we haven't opened the applications yet. We're going to open the application probably towards the end of May or June. But this is something you should be aware of. The things that we're going to require from the startups when we provide the 200,000 baht are information rights, because our goal is basically to track and keep under radar all these 100 startups and see if there can be some interesting ones. And we will do follow-on investments in the most promising ones. So maybe it's going to be 20 companies, maybe it's going to be 30 companies at the end of the year. We haven't decided yet. That really depends on the performance of each company. So that's why we're going to ask for information rights. Another thing that we're going to ask for would be first rights of refusal in case if you want to do further round of funding. If you want to raise money, you're going to have to ask us if we want to invest in your company before you ask anyone else. That's it for now. That's all we're going to ask. It's no equity, So I think it's a great, amazing opportunity for startups to really get going and build a prototype, especially at the ideation stage. So now we're gonna dive into the topic of today. So business model canvas is something that we run once every 2 months. That's part of the innovation workshops that we organize every Wednesday. So today is business model canvas. Another Wednesday is gonna be startup Wednesday. Another Wednesday is gonna be growth hacking or design thinking, etc. So today we're gonna talk about business model canvas and how the business model is such a big piece of a sustainable business. You know, you may have an idea, you may have a technology in mind, you may have a service in mind, but without a business model, you won't be able to make your business sustainable. So it's really about empowering your technology with a business model. And that's how we're gonna talk about it today. So taking the example of Xerox, everyone knows Xerox photocopy machinery. First, it was called Halloween. And in 1959, an amazing American engineer came up with a great invention, which was the modern photocopy machine. Previously, photocopy machines could only make 15 to 20 copies a day, but this machine could make up to 2,000 copies a day. So it was a big revolution. However, they only had that technology. And first, they were approaching the big boys, you know, GE, IBM, Kodak, but none of them wanted to partner with Xerox. So they had to come up with an idea. How were they gonna sell the machine? So instead of selling it to offices at a very high cost, they decided to actually lease the equipment and charge per copy fee for copies in excess of 2,000 copies per month. And that was a big revolution there. You know, they were providing all the required supplies, service, and supports, and they took the big risk that customer could cancel the lease on only 15 days notice. So the customer was not attached at all to Xerox. They could cancel at any time. But it was a bold move. And you know, they didn't know if it was gonna work or not. That's the main thing here. The customers were only committed to monthly lease payments. So just to show you that business model can be very important. Here, Google. You know, we've been using Google for the past 20 years now. And we may wonder, how do they really monetize the business, you know? At that time, maybe there was Yahoo, there were other search engines that had the technology, but how did they come up with this idea of monetizing their technology using advertisers? And they were charging advertisers AdWords and cost per click, and that was a great innovation there. So the points in common, you know, between Xerox and Google, the first one is that the technology was not sufficient. It was not enough. They really had to come up with an idea so that the business model could empower the technology. You know, technology, at the end of the day, is crucial, is the core part. But you really have to wonder how your business model can really fit with the technology together, give you some. And also, they did not copy existing business models, since none of this technology had been invented previously. So they had to be very innovative. And the last point is that they had to test the business model. They didn't know before they got out of the building if it was gonna work or not. So, you know, the three things that we don't do well when it comes to business models. And that's how the business model canvas is so helpful, because it allows you to structure. Then how do you come up with innovative and great business models? You know, maybe you got an idea, but it may not be the good one. So you have to iterate and you have to change some hypotheses in your business model. And then how do you test the business model? You may have a good idea, but you know, it's on your paper. Until you get out of your building and really test it, it doesn't mean anything. case study of Nespresso. You know, coffee has become a huge commodity business. It's been growing 15% year on year for the past 50 years at least. Vietnam, if you look at it, 20 years ago, Vietnam didn't produce an ounce of coffee. Now it's become the second biggest producer of coffee in the world. Switzerland, they drink a lot of coffee. I'm going to ask you a question. How much do you think the cost of home consumption for the coffee in Swiss households over the last couple of years, over the last 5 years, let's say, changed? Did it increase? Did it decrease or increase? And by how much? If anyone has a guess, is it like 20% more, 20% less, 50% more? Anyone want to try? Okay, so the answer is 600 to 800 more. Is Nespresso. Nespresso is one of the fastest growing units within Nestle. So Nestle is a Swiss brand, as you know, and Nespresso has been growing 35% per year since 2000. And at the core of this success is the machinery and the caps. But in the first place, when they came up with this idea, they didn't have any business model. Actually, their first business model was to approach offices and sell the machines to the offices. So what do you think made Nespresso so successful? What do you think are the key points of the business model that they had come with that makes them so successful? Yeah, this is one. So how did it, what did they do to make it like a recurring revenue?
After you bought the machine, you will need to buy the customer.
Okay, so the lady here said that it's because of the recurring revenue of the capsules, and that's totally right. So what allowed them to actually get recurring revenue for that is the patent, is the intellectual property. So that's one thing. Another thing is that instead of selling the machines only through Nespresso stores, they actually were able to convince many distributors to sell the machines. So a lot of people were buying the machines from many, many ways, many, many channels. Even though they were not making a lot of money for the machines, because a lot of the margins were captured by the distributors, at least they were sure that a lot of households had the machines. And then the caps were only sold through their own channel, that's why. It was only sold through either their website or their own stores. So they could capture the whole margin. And that's the most important thing of it. So other than the IP, one of the other key factors were the brand. So they invested in a lot in, you know, marketing. They invested a lot in the machinery. They had to be sure that they could come up with some very high quality products. So investing in machinery mainly. And since they saw that this was an amazing success, then they deployed other kinds of machines, such as machines for tea, machines for baby products, baby milk, and machines for cappuccinos. So it's kind of like a business model portfolios that they created out of that model. So just a few tips when it comes to create your business model. First is that you shouldn't try to, you know, fall in love with your first idea. You should explore many different options. You know, you should think, what if you give your product for free, for instance? How can you monetize on the side? What if you don't have any fixed costs? What if it's all based on variable costs? Another question you can ask is, what if you want to partner with your main competitors? Maybe that's a way to go for. So don't settle down and keep on, you know, talking, conversing with your ideas, and that's really about the prototyping. And then when you got the ideas, it's not enough to have some hypothesis written on your piece of paper because it doesn't mean anything. So you really have to test all the hypotheses behind your business model. And then for that, you have to design some experimentations. So you need to get out of the building and test all these hypotheses, which are going to give you some insights. And then you're going to be able to apply this insight onto your business model. So your final business model should really get all your hypotheses that were already tested out. That's very important. So now we're going to dive deep into the 9 building blocks of the business model canvas. So first, you have to start with the value proposition, always. Value proposition is what makes you really unique, what distinguishes you from your competitors. You know, the value propositions may be, you know, either quantitative, whether it's price and efficiency, or qualitative. Qualitative means you target an overall customer experience and outcome. Once you decided of your value proposition, then the first step before anyone else should be the customer segment. You have to think about which customers you're going to target, and you have to segment them, because you have to identify how the needs and the attributes of each customer segment are different from each other. That's the only way you're going to be able to meet the characteristics of each selected group. Then, once you have identified all the customer segments that you're going to serve, distribution channels, how are you going to deliver your value proposition to your customers? An effective channel will distribute your value proposition in a way that is fast, efficient, and cost effective. There are many ways to get your own channels or to decide of your channels. Either you have your own ones, maybe a storefront, or you can use distributors. You know, therefore, there are partners that might capture a bit of your margin, but at least you know that it's going to be quite efficient. So maybe you want to just and don't spend too much time, you know, create your own channel. Therefore, you're going to have to use partners. Then you're going to have to think about which kind of customer relationships you want to build. And this is really going to ensure the survival and the success of your business. So once you have done value proposition and customers, then it's going to be about the key resources. What are the key resources that you're going to need to build your value proposition? Let's look at pen manufacturer, for instance. You know, the pens called Bic, the brand. Their goal is to deliver a very cheap pen. So they're going to focus on making a very efficient supply chain in order to drive down the costs. That's where you have the key resources. So key resources, you know, for a pen like Bic, you're going to need factory, you're going to need people, you're going to need probably intellectual property as well, so that you ensure yourself that nobody's going to copy the exact same pen that you created. And you're going to need, of course, financial support, either from investors or you're going to reinvest the money that you're making. And then it's going to be the partner network. And that's what I was talking a bit earlier before, you know. If you really want to focus on your core activity, why not just partnering with some people such as, you know, a supplier, instead of creating an integrated value chain, vertically integrated, why don't you just outsource some parts? You know, like CP, for instance. They provide the seed for the chickens, but they could easily get someone to supply the seeds. They don't have to do that. So it takes a lot of energy and money to actually build your partner network, but at the end of the day, if you want to focus on your core activity, it's quite worthwhile. Then when you have decided of your partner's activities and resources, it's going to be about the cost structure. And the cost structure is very important. Which kind of business structures do you want to provide to your business? Is it going to be cost-driven, such as low-cost airlines? Or is it going to be value-driven, you know, like Louis Vuitton or Rolex, which is based on brand and status? Then you're going to think about the cost structures. Which kind of fixed costs are you going to attribute to your business? Which kind of variable costs? Also, you're going to have to think about economies of scales and economies of scope. Economies of scope, because a lot of people know economies of scale, which is, you know, the more you produce, the cheaper the incremental product to make is going to be cheaper. But economies of scope is, for instance, you make chickens and pork at the same time, and you have to store all of this. Well, it's probably cheaper for you to create these two products instead of just one and leave some unutilized space in the fridge. So that's economies of scope. And then, of course, revenue stream. How are you going to make the money? How do you expect your customer to pay for your product? How much do you think they are able to pay for your product? So customer segments, there are many ways to approach this. You can combine some of this, or you can just pick up one of them. And all of these industries or companies on the right-hand side have decided to just pick one of them. So we're going to play a game, and I'm going to ask you to guess which one corresponds to which one. So starting with, you know, mass market, what do you think matches mass market in all of the choices in red? No. No. Consumer electronics? Yeah. So it's consumer electronics for mass market. How about niche market? Car part manufacturer, yes, that's right. Segment. It's actually the retail arm of Krungsri Bank. This one is a bit hard, actually. You know, the services that a bank provides to its customers really depend on the worth of the individual. That's why they have to segment their clients. Now diversified, CP, because all of the business that they are into, and multi-sided platform, credit card company. Okay. A credit card company, multi-sided platform, because credit card companies such as Visa, for instance, they have to both convince the end user, the people who carry the cards, as well as the shops to get the machines. Value propositions, so same, you know, you can combine some of the value propositions, but on the right-hand side, all these companies have just picked one. So, same game. Newness.
Cell phones?
Yeah, cell phones. Performance. Yeah. Rolls, yeah. Rolls Royce. Customization. Sorry, which one?
Tailor-made Nike shoes.
Yes, that's right. Okay, getting the job done.
AirAsia.
Not AirAsia.
But it's very important to get to the destination.
Right, yeah.
Mutual funds.
No mutual funds. No. Cell phones is already taken.
Cell phones.
Not Salesforce. PCs, yeah. Okay. Design.
Fashion
brand, yeah. Brand status.
Rolex.
Price. AirAsia, yeah. Cost reduction. Salesforce, yeah. And accessibility, mutual funds. And accessibility really for mutual funds is the rationale behind is that anyone can apply for a mutual fund. So talking about channels, you know, as I was discussing before, if you want to create your own channels versus partnering with someone, that's gonna cost much more money. But at the end of the day, you're gonna be able to capture all the value that you're gonna deliver to your customers and the price that they are able to pay for it. And then, you know, creating a channel, there are many faces, you know, getting your customer aware of your product. How are you gonna allow your customer to evaluate your product? You know, TripAdvisor is doing it very well, for instance, through reviews, purchase, which channels in this case are you gonna use? Is it like website, stores, then delivery? The goal here is really to deliver the product in the most efficient and the fastest way, and then the after sales kind of support that you're gonna bring. Back to the game, customer relationship now. Personal assistance. Yeah, it's call centers, yeah. And dedicated personal assistance is private banking. Yeah. Self-service. I think self-service is Tinder, yeah. and automated is Amazon, right, yeah. Communities.
LinkedIn
groups. And co-creation, YouTube. Yeah. Okay. revenue streams now. Different ways to monetize your product. Asset sale. Yeah, Toyota. Usage fee.
The hotels.
Hotel, yeah. Subscription fee.
Online
game, yeah. Lending, renting. Hertz car. Licensing. The voice, yeah, licensing. Brokerage fee?
Investment bank.
Investment bank, yeah. advertising, influencers blog. Yeah. Cool. So now we're gonna have a little look at a case study, Skype. So Skype has been created, if I'm not mistaken, around 2000. So really, to you know, to be a competition to telecommunications companies. So the value proposition is you know, very similar to what the telcos out there are offering, except that it's free, and you get video calling, which is pretty amazing. So you can also have the option to get cheap calls to call phones if you want through the Skype out option. So this is for the value proposition. Customer segments, web users globally. As long as you have the internet, Wi-Fi, you can call someone for free as long as this person has already Skype downloaded on its computers. And also, another customer segment is people that want to call phones. And especially from a country to another, it's much cheaper than just using your phones and the telco subscription. Customer relationship, mass customized. This is not very personally dedicated or tailored. For the key activities, you know, software development, not much other than that. Key resources, software developers and software. Key partners, payment providers. So maybe, I don't know what they're using, but you know, PayPal, Omise, like in Thailand. Telco partners, yes, they need to partner up with them because some people want to use Skype to call some other phones. Distribution providers, same for the Wi-Fi. Cost structure, software development, and complaint management. That's pretty much it. And revenue streams, a lot is for free. So this is why we call it a freemium business model. And a lot of, you know, companies out there, like current startups, are using this kind of business model. They're delivering a lot for free and monetizing just a little part. You know, like I'm thinking Tinder, for instance, right? Like it's free for everyone to use, but if you want to use some certain features, you're gonna have to pay. That's pretty much the same thing here. Now, comparing Skype versus telecommunication. The value proposition is roughly similar. Voice offer. Customer segments, pretty much the same, except that Skype has a global reach. I would say telco aim at becoming a company that has global reach through the roaming features that it provides, but this is very expensive. Here you got global reach for free for everyone. In terms of channels, software distribution, 100% low-cost channels. That's much better than telcos that have to pay for the infrastructure, the network. Customer relationship, this is completely automated, whereas, you know, for telcos sometimes they have to set up some call centers and have to be providing tailored solutions to their clients. Key resources, as I said, no infrastructure for Skype, only a software. You know, telco companies, they have to pay millions and millions to build a network. Skype doesn't have to do that. Key activities, software development and no network maintenance. That's a cost that they take out compared to telcos. Key partners, you know, they try to maximum the outsource of the activities. Cost structure, same as a software company. And revenue streams, 90% free, only 10% paying. Okay, so now I'm gonna ask you to build some groups. We would like 7 groups to make a business model canvas on your own. So you're gonna have to pick one of these companies out there, and each of the paper on the window here corresponds to a specific company that is on the slide here. And you know, I don't know how much time we got, maybe half an hour to come up with a business model canvas. Is that okay? So you're going to have to make your own business model canvas, and then, you know, we're going to help each other, and then, you know, if someone wants. Actually, you can stay here with AirAsia. It's okay? Different kinds of segments, the hosts and the guests.
Yes. So just in the big picture about the
yes.
Hosts
yes.
The guests.
Yes. You don't have
understanding of Meituan is mainly as a consumer. So we cannot really go deep into that business model. So we will be financial. Like banks or companies like PayPal who manage internet, transaction.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then the cost structure. I think obviously it's because they are so big. The main keyword is the economic of scale. Right? They could. And last but not least, the revenue stream. So they take the commission from all the sales, right? And then another big component is the subscription fee. So yeah, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Everything was pretty much right. I'm just gonna add some items. So for the value proposition, the solution mentions the convenience. The price, because it's much cheaper than any other website. The instant fulfillment with e-reader, I think to make the logistics even faster. And the vast selection.
Okay.
A segment, global consumer market, yes, completely. Then there's also an individual niche, because I think the rationale behind is that on Amazon you can find some really niche products that you can't find anywhere else. But you can also find some products that appeal to like the mass. Customer relationship, self-service, and automated service, both. Key resources, physical warehouses, and human, yeah, totally. Key activities. So they also do production and design, actually, for their e-books. And they do merchandising. Key partners, logistics partners, yes. Network of sellers, yes. And then affiliates as well. Affiliates, for instance, blogs, and they would pay a fee to the blog if someone clicks on the link to get access to Amazon. So this is a lot of commission as well, yeah. And authors and publishers for the ebooks. Cost structure, low cost structure, economies of scale, you said it. IT and fulfillment infrastructure, yes. Revenue streams, subscription fee, you said it. Commissions on reseller sales, and not only commissions on the sales that they make themselves. So, because I'm trying to sell some things on Amazon as well, so I'm trying to become a reseller. And they actually take a very high fees when I sell something on Amazon. It's very high. So for a product that, for instance, I buy from China, like $3, and I want to sell it on Amazon at $25, they would take, let's say, $10. So in these $10, $6 would be the price for the logistics, so for the warehouse, and $4 is like a commission out of the final price. So there are two ways that they are monetized. Then acquisitions and investments, but that's pretty much any company that can do that. And ebooks and content. Thank you. Next is Airbnb.
Okay. First of all, we will start at the first part. It should be the value proposition. So we think as we are the Airbnb owner, the value proposition, we should give the unique experience for the traveler, like a native style, urban style, that the general hotel cannot provide for any customer. And the number two, number three, we think the proposition that customer will get, it should be comfortable and friendly living in the different location. And should be, I think, preventing safety living. It should be the key factor for this part. New experience around the world that anyone that have the power for traveling can take this opportunity. Website is an online the four. Number four is customer relationship. We think the first factor should be the family caring. The number two is the comfortable and good connection. The number three, it should be the safety caring for the guest who using this service. We move to the number five, the key resources. This imply for the thing that we have to build our business. So the number one should be system platform. The number two should be customer and house owner or accommodation owner, something like this. So the number six key activity is the thing that we have to do our business. It should start with the connection to the connection making, yeah, between guest and host. The number two should be the system development that we have to do to build for our system service. So the part number seven, key partner, we think we should have a host owner. Host owner and the guest, that's like we are the middle platform to make connection between host owner and guest to use his service. So the last one is that, the number eight part is a cost structure. We think we have to do with the commission fee. Commission fee should be the main part of our cost structure. The thing that we have to pay for to do this business is a system software development. It should be our payment also. So the last one, the nine part is the part number nine is the revenue stream we can get from to be 90% free from guests or membership, and we will get about 10% from the commission free. I think that's all. It should be like this.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So for value propositions, since it's a platform, yes, there is unique experience, comfortable places, good locations. So that's for the host side. So value proposition, actually, there are like two sides, the host and the guest. So host is really targeting people that want to earn money by renting their space aside their main activities. And also offering an insurance to the house owners. The guests in a hotel, they can book at someone's place, and the pricing is most of the time much cheaper than in the hotel. For the customer segment, yes, traveling lovers, totally. That's for the guests. And for the host, people that want to make extra money and want to meet new people. Customer relationships, customer service, social media, promotional offers, and home insurance. For the channels, you said website, yes, and mobile apps. For key resources, local hosts, you said, technology as well, yes. Skilled employees. Key activities, you said system development, connection making, that's totally right. And also building the host network and managing the host. Key partners, host and guests, as well as payment processors, investors in this case, and photographers. Because sometimes they hire photographers to go take the pictures of the host places. Yes.
Make it more attractive.
Exactly. Yeah.
Thank you.
And cost structure, salaries to employees, of course, and payments to freelance photographers, and yeah, revenue streams. You're right. Commissions. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now it's Uber.
Hello everyone. Our team is Uber team. The idea of the Uber come from the idea such as sharing economies. That is the main important part is about to sharing our car. Yes. And first is the value proposition of Uber. As I told you that the ideas come from, let's say, what if we want to go to somewhere, and when I drive my own car alone, and if someone want to go to that destination that is the same as me, and I think, how can I monetize the money or extra money? So I ask them to go with me, okay, and I can monetize the money from what we do to that. That is the main idea of the Uber. So the first is The first value proposition is for safety and convenience. And we provide a reasonable price for the passenger. And we have a good training to our driver. And after we have a good service to our passenger. We have a good branding to make a reliable brand to make sure that the passenger can feel secure while they travel with us. So the second part is customer segment. Customer segment is for all passengers. So first I would like to focus, for example, who have to use taxi, the commuters who have to travel to go to work every day, or maybe the travelers who come from different countries can use this application. The third part is channel. The first part is application download. So we allow the user to download application on the App Store, something like that. And we also promote our product in social media. And we also use offline to advertise the product by go to exhibition and have a booth to explain, to describe what we're doing in our product. And we also use email to advertise to our target customer. The fourth is customer relationship. We giving passenger can give rate to driver and can also give rating for application. And we also get a key code with customer by give them a promotion code to reduce the cost. And for the five parties, key resources. Key resources, the first contact with personal car owners, that is the main part of our product. And another resources is IT support. For instance, server or IT. Activities is about software development, because we are also and also go to exhibition. Seven is key partners. Our partner is car providers and rental car company. The important part for our partner is government. Yeah. So Uber try to convince government to agree with them today. The cost structure is about application fee and software development, and also sales and marketing. And the last is complaint management. This is the main cost structure. The last is nice revenue streams. Revenue streams, we from usage fee and commission and from advertising. And the last is from partner commission. Okay, that's it for our presentation.
Thank you very much. So the value proposition, You said safety, convenience, reasonable price, brand. Yes, that's all right. I would have added the minimum waiting time. You know, they try to make it very fast for the car to arrive at your place. Also, cashless ride. So instead of paying cash, you can just use your credit card. Also, you can see the estimated time of the arrival. That's something that the usual taxis can't provide you. And then on the driver side, you try to target people that want additional source of income, a flexible working schedules that can work part-time, easy payment procedure, so they get transferred the money, you know, every 2 weeks, for instance, and drivers can get paid to be online, even without their request. So that's enough. Customer segments now. Users, the people who don't own a car, who like to travel in style, who wants a cost-efficient cab. On the driver's side, people who own a car and want to earn money, who love to drive, and who wish to be partners instead of drivers. The key resources, yeah, you were all right. IT platform and skilled drivers. Key activities, marketing, yes, that's a lot. Exhibitions, hiring drivers, managing the driver payouts. Key partners, yes, government, the drivers, the map API providers, that's important, Google Map in this case, yeah. The payment processors as well. I don't know, I think it's PayPal that they're using in the US. In terms of cost structure, you were all right. IT, marketing, salaries, revenue streams. So there's one thing that is very important in the revenue streams is a surge pricing. When there's a lot of demand, the price increases very quickly. You know, sometimes like 2 times, 3 times. So that's a way that they manage to monetize even more. It's really about supply and demand. Not a lot of companies are able to do this, but this is very interesting. And also there are many segments of cars. I'm not sure in Thailand, but in the US there is Uber X, Uber Black, Uber SUV. There's also Uber Pool, if you want to take the cab with someone else. So there are different ways to monetize this. Yeah. Thank you very much. Now it's Facebook's turn. Oh, sorry. Oh, it's okay, it's okay, it's okay. It's okay, it's okay.
So for Facebook team, we start from the value proposition. Well, everyone knows Facebook is a social network website and application. Basically, the features, there are features for general users, value proposition. Then on the customer segment, there are the global internet general users and also like on the business side, as I mentioned already. Then we come to channel that at the moment there are
data center, something like Facebook data center or Google data center. And they also require the call center to support their operation when something goes wrong. For the key partner to do the business, any kind of the bank, financial company, online commerce platform, the payment platform in the world, they connect to the whole thing. For the cost factor, for sure, they must have the developer to do the payment technology platform, and also they must hire the highest personnel to do the call center operation. I think that's all. Thank you.
Thank you. I think you forgot the revenue.
Oh, okay, the last.
So, yes, cashless cashless payments for the value propositions, as well as convenience, security, rewards, also for the merchants, improved sales, and customer convenience. Customer segments. So here on the on one side you got the cardholders, and on the other side you got the merchants. These guys are your customers as well. The financial institutions as well. You have to convince them to not take MasterCard. You have to sell Visa. So both really the issuers of the card as well as the acquirer, the consumer who's going to use the card. For the channels, sponsorships. So like Visa might sponsor FIFA World Cup. Also TV advertisements, conference. So relationships, yes, rewards and points. Key resources. You said Visa payment platform. And another one is a Visa brand. They pay a lot to build a brand. Key activities, network management, transaction processing, yes. Key partners, technology, alliances, as well as commercial partners. The cost structure, the personal, yes. And one I think is very important as well is litigations provision. If someone gets stolen the card, so there has to be some insurance for that. And the brand promotion, etc. And revenue streams, yes, commissions, processing revenue, international revenue as well. Yeah, thank you very much. I'm just gonna finish, we got 5 more minutes. So the top 10 business model pitfalls, what you have to avoid at all costs when you want to build your own business model. So the first thing is not knowing how you will measure success. So, you know, sometimes you meet startups, they have 20 people in their team, they're growing very fast, but just for the sake of growing, they actually don't aim at reaching any goal. On the other side, you have another startup that could grow much faster, but that thinks that it's enough to stay at where they are. So it's very important to know what you define as your success. Is it to build a 100 million valuation company? Is it to build a 10 million company? Or is it just to have an impact, you know, in the universe? So that's why it's very important to begin with a man in mind. You can really step up and see if your business model can allow you to reach that goal. The second one is marketing to everyone. Facebook, for instance, you know, it started targeting Harvard University students. The goal is not to please everyone, the whole world, you know. Everyone wants to build a product from day one that everyone will like. That's a big mistake. First, you have to please the early adopters. And these people have different characteristics from the mainstream people. But these people are very important for you. You shouldn't try to leapfrog them, you know, because these people are gonna get you the momentum that will allow you to jump over the chasm here, from early adopter to mainstream user. Careful not to narrow it too much, because you might end up getting there, which is another pitfall. So you know, in computer science, there is optimization technique that's called hill climbing, and basically, you tend to find better solutions by incrementally changing a single element of the solution. And then that might allow you to end up here. But there's take out your blindfold, and then you're gonna realize that there's another top, and you miss out completely on the very big picture. So don't try to execute too fast. Really take your time to sketch out business models very different from each other in parallel, and then test out the hypothesis. Another pitfall is, you know, not having the So unfair advantage story, you know, it's at the beginning. And it's not something that you test in one day either. When you get out, when you're gonna get out in the market. These competitors will tell you, or will show you if you have an unfair advantage or not. If you don't, you're gonna be displaced. Here we're gonna talk about, you know, not having a weak or not having a strong unique is to make your competition completely irrelevant. To get there, it's a lot of testing. The seventh one, so you know, for every startup at the beginning, there are three main milestones. The first one is, do you really have a problem that is worth solving? Because there are many challenges right out there, many problems, but is it worth solving? Because maybe there's not gonna be some demand for that. Second milestone is really product market fit, right? Like, have you built something that people want, really? And the third milestone is, how are you gonna be able to accelerate? You have validated the product market fit. You know, product market fit, some here is that you should have enough runway. You have to be careful to be able to get to your next milestone. So if you're looking for a VC, you're gonna try to set up some traction and customer engagement KPIs, and be sure that, you know, you have at least set them up so that the VCs can understand them. But even better, if you have reached these KPIs, the VC is gonna definitely look at you. If you bootstrap, I think it's very important for you to understand where is your break-even point and set up some like time constraints. Break-even point in 6 months. Okay, at the end of the 6 months, it's postponed by something wrong in here. It's either you budgeted very badly, or it's because your product might not reach product market fit. Here, it's really about, okay, you got a product, people like it, but if you haven't built a scalable channel to sell products, it's meaningless, right? Whether you can build a scalable channel or not is gonna determine whether you're gonna be able to scale and reach out to more people. That's what really matters when you reach product market fit. Here, you know, how do you think customers are gonna pay for your product? How much do you expect that they value your product and are able to pay for your product? And finally, the last pitfall is solution. Maybe you have a product, but it doesn't mean that it's the solution. The solution, you're gonna build it when you're gonna get out of the building and really face customers. Some feedback. were just building this because we thought it was awesome. He's talking about the product. He's not talking about the solution. The solution came up after. He realized, oh, actually, my product can fit a real business, and I'm going to build a business model around it. And that's why he's here now, because he didn't jump. Students, his friends, and then saw the opportunity. Yeah, that's it for today. Thank you very much for coming, everyone. I'm just gonna reiterate what I've said earlier at the beginning, that we're gonna soon be funding 100 startups by the end of the year. So 20 out of them, we would like them to be social enterprises, to have a social and or environmental impact. 30 out of them, we think should be ideation stage companies that don't have any prototype yet, because we really want to motivate very young entrepreneurs, and we think that 200,000 baht would be enough to build a prototype or an application or whatever you think would be relevant to your business. And then the 50 remaining companies, we believe that it would be best to target companies that already have a prototype, and that we think you could support in terms of, you know, it's also media, producing our own content, which is very different from any other telecommunications companies out there. We got cloud services, we got e-commerce, we got true e-money wallets, so that can attract a lot of fintech startups that could be interested there. Logistics, you know, think about ASEND. ASEND is also part of the entire CP group. It's our cousin. They're taking care of the logistics backend for e-commerce websites. You know, they have invested in Sendit, which is a last mile delivery motorcycle startup. They have invested in Obise, which is a payment platform. And they have invested in BusCP, which is a customer relationship management for online businesses. And ASEN, you know, we partner with that can build some strategy fit with or very well. And, you know, even talking about True or ASEN only, I'm talking about the overall CP groups, agri-tech businesses that can be very interesting to us. So we'll wait for your applications. And before that, I also would like to reiterate the incubation and scale-up program, that applications will close at the end of April. And to repeat what I said earlier, we provide 700,000 baht of cash funding as well as 1 million baht of media value for between 5 and 9% of ownership stake, depending on your development. That's what we will decide after the 3 months bootcamp. So incubation and scale up will be starting in beginning of June, 3 months bootcamp, intense mentoring sessions. One mentor every week that comes here towards the end of the week. We got internal as well as external mentors. Our external mentors are serial entrepreneurs from Thailand, but also from overseas. Mentors would be coming from True Corporation and would be people that can really help you identify you know, the pain points of your business, as well as where we can build a strategic fit between business units and your business. Yeah, so thank you very much for coming today, and hope you have a nice Songkran holiday. Thank you.